I am that I am. Oh, we give him thanks this morning. And the word is unrestricted access. Unrestricted access. And our scripture this morning was already read, but I'll just pick out just one this morning and we will make our way down into the other scriptures. And it is taken from Hebrews 10, 19 to 20. And I'll read two versions this morning. The first is from the Message version, which is, so friends, we can now without hesitation walk right up to God into the holy place. Jesus has cleared the way by the blood of his sacrifice, acting as our priest before God. The curtain into God's presence is his body. Hallelujah. The New Century Version says, so brothers and sisters, we are completely free to enter the most holy place without fear because of the blood of Jesus' death. We can enter through a new and living way that Jesus opened for us. It leads through the curtain, Christ's body, this morning. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. We just want to honor him this morning. Father, we lift you up. Hallelujah, this morning. Take your rightful place, Lord, as we are about to go into your word, Father. Hallelujah. As I'm about to decrease and you increase, Father, have your way today. Wield your sword, Lord God, this morning. Cut asunder, oh God, anything that does not belong, Lord, so your word will go forth with clarity, with power, and with might this morning. We give you all the praise and all the glory for what you are about to do in this word, Almighty Yahweh, through this word, Almighty Yahweh. And we give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. And we tell you thanks right now in this way. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Glory. Today's word is unrestricted access. Unrestricted access this morning. Hallelujah. So I just want to take you to what Modern Dictionary says about unrestricted access. The dictionary defines unrestricted access as uncontrolled, meaning you are free to do what you want without being limited by any rules. You are not limited by any rules. But this morning, what does God says regarding unrestricted access about you and I this morning and what access we have towards him? I'll tell you right from the word. John 14, verse 6 says, Jesus told him, hallelujah, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Hebrews 10 and 19 through 20 says, so brothers and sisters, we are completely free to enter the most holy place without fear because of the blood of Jesus' death. We can enter through a new and living way that Jesus opened for us. It leads through the curtain, Christ's body. Romans 5 and 2 says, because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. Ephesians 2 and 18 says, now all of us can come to the Father through the same Holy Spirit because of what Christ has done for us. Ephesians 3 and 12 says, because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come boldly and stand confidently in God's presence. That's what unrestricted access mean. Hallelujah, this morning. That is unrestricted access this morning. That is the God-given definition this morning from John all the way to Ephesians this morning. In other words, as God's children, we have one of the greatest privileges ever bestowed on humankind. We have the right, the boldness, and the freedom to break in on our Lord at any time this morning. I want you to underscore that we can break in on our Lord at any time. That's what unrestricted access means this morning. Our Heavenly Father sits on the throne in eternity, and at his right hand sits his Son, our blessed Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Outside this throne room are gates which open to all who are in Christ this morning. Hallelujah. Meaning at any time, any day or night, fall, winter, spring, and summer, around the clock, 24/7, 365 days of the year, we can bypass guardian angels, the seraphims, and all the heavenly hosts to boldly enter into these gates and approach our Father's throne. Do you understand this morning? The gift that you got, do you understand this morning the access that you got? Do you understand the privilege that you got this morning? Christ has provided us with direct access to the Father to receive all the mercy and grace we need, no matter what our circumstances are. No matter what our circumstances are. Hallelujah. We have direct access to the Father this morning to receive all the mercy and the grace that we need. I sure need some grace. I sure need some mercy. And his mercy's on you every morning. Grace is his faithfulness. Oh Lord, unto me. Glory, hallelujah. That's what you got this morning, because you have unrestricted access. So today's message is a pivotal turning point, moment, a watershed moment that emphasizes the concept of unrestricted access to God through Jesus Christ. It traces the historical progression of this access from the Old Testament, when access to God was limited to specific individuals. This morning, to the tearing of the veil in the temple at the death of Jesus, symbolizing the opening of direct access to God for all believers. Not some, but for all believers this morning. So today's message underscores the following points that I want you to take note of this morning. There's a historical background, meaning that the Old Testament era had limited access to God with only a few individuals like Abraham and Moses and many more enjoying a close relationship with God. Number two, access through sacrifice and rituals. The people of Israel had to approach God through sacrifices and rituals at the tabernacle. The high priest alone had access to the holies of holies, and that too only once a year, the Day of Atonement. Number three, restricted access in the New Testament. Even when Jesus was physically present on earth, access to him was restricted by geographical and logistical challenges. Only a specific few could be physically close to him. Number four, the tearing of the veil. The death of Jesus is presented as a pivotal moment, symbolized by the tearing of the veil in the temple. This event signifies the removal of barriers between God and humanity, providing unrestricted access to God through the sacrifice of Jesus. Number five, the call to prayer, the importance of prayer and regular communion with God. Despite the privilege of unrestricted access, some believers neglect this vital aspect of their relationship with God. We neglect it. We don't even think about it. It's only when trouble meets us, that's when we run on in. But we must not neglect this vital aspect of our relationship with God. Number six, it's the warning against lukewarmness. This morning, there is a parallel with the church in Sardis from the book of Revelation, highlighting the danger of becoming lukewarm and neglecting the practice of prayer. Prayer should be your lifestyle. It is who you are, day in and day out. Whether I feel like it, whether I don't want to, it should be your, hallelujah, lifestyle this morning. And seven, and last, the eternal significance. The concluding point of today's message will underscore the eternal significance of maintaining a vibrant connection, an intimate connection with God through prayer, suggesting that prayerlessness may lead to spiritual decline. It will lead to spiritual decline and a state of spiritual barrenness. But be encouraged today to appreciate and utilize the extraordinary privilege of unrestricted access to God that has been made possible through the sacrificial work of Jesus Christ this morning. And a call to prayer, hallelujah. Prayer is our lifestyle, and a warning against the complacency in maintaining, hallelujah. You must maintain a vibrant relationship with God. I hope somebody is hearing me on the internet this morning. Carleen never goes live. But this morning I felt the need. The Lord unctioned me this morning to go live because the Lord has something to say. Hallelujah. He's got a warning. The sirens are going off throughout the earth this morning. And he's saying, you got unrestricted access to me. Let the devil not fool you and tell you that nothing ain't going on, because I'm moving in the secret places. Hallelujah. I'm going in the deepest valleys. Hallelujah. I'm climbing the highest mountain just for you, because you have unrestricted access to me. So you the keys this morning and press to the inner court. Hallelujah. This morning. Glory. So key point number one, the historical background, we cannot deny it because it's the foundation on which we stand. So in the Old Testament, no person had access to the Father, with the exception of a few people. So for example, we know that Abraham enjoyed a measure of access to the Lord. And God refers to Abraham, this devout man, as my friend in Isaiah 41 verse 8. Abraham heard from the Lord. He talked to the Lord. He had communion with him. Yet even Abraham remained outside the veil. Underscore that. Even Abraham remained outside of the veil. Even though he was a friend of God, he never had access to the Holy of Holies this morning where God resided. The spiritual veil of separation had not yet been ripped into somebody. The spiritual veil of separation had not yet set, been ripped into. At one point in Israel's history, God declared that he would speak to the prophets through visions and dreams. In Numbers 12 and 6 says, if there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision and will speak unto him in a dream. This was a very restricted access to God. Yet again, there was an exception. Moses, a leader of Israel, God said in Romans 12, 7-8, my servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all mine house. With him will I speak mouth to mouth, even appearingly and not in dark speeches. And the similitude of the Lord shall he behold. Like Abraham, Moses talked to God. And God talked to him. He spent 40 days and nights in the Lord's presence until his face shone. Clearly, Moses had a great measure of access. He had access. He had a measure of access. He didn't have full access, but he had a measure of access. But the rest of Israel knew nothing of this kind of access. But you know what? Key point number two is access through sacrifice and rituals. So they didn't know nothing of this kind of access. The Lord said to them in Exodus 29, 42 through 43, there shall be a continual burnt offering throughout your generations at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord, where I will meet you to speak there unto you, and there I will meet with the children of Israel. Meaning that no one was allowed to enter the Holy of Holies, where God's presence abode. Only was allowed to go in on one day of the year, the Day of Atonement. Therefore, the people had to bring their sacrifices to the door of the tabernacle. They could peek through the door, but they couldn't behold anything full. Is somebody hearing me this morning? They could peek through the door. Do you know what a peek mean? I wish I had a door right here. I would show you that all you do is just crack the door and you could peek in, but you don't have full access, hallelujah, to go into the door. They could only wonder at the majesty of God's glory dwelling inside, because they could not go inside. Again, there was a very restricted access. It was as if God were saying to them, come to my front door, but I'll meet you there. Come to my front door, and I will meet you there. Then we can talk. So imagine going to somebody's house, and all you are allowed to do is to just stand at the door, but you couldn't enter in through the door. So this is what was happening back then. They could come to the front door and they would meet him there, but then they would only talk. That's all they could do, but they could not enter therein. But they weren't invited inside. My God. They were not invited inside. Imagine yourself going to somebody's house, but all you're allowed to do is to stay on the outside, on the front porch, but you're not invited inside. The Lord spoke to them from the other side of the tabernacle door. Can you imagine trying to communicate with a close friend? Hallelujah, your bosom friend, that way that all you're allowed to do is to communicate, hallelujah, from the other side of the door, inside the tabernacle, a veil separated the holy place from the holy of holies. As the high priest approached the veil, he must have been trembling and shaking in his boots. While it was an awesome experience, it was yet fearful to have access to God's glory. If you committed just one defilement in his presence, you will be struck dead. My God. Because God's holy presence could not abide in with sin or anything of its kind. You'll be struck dead. So can you imagine the high priest and the weight that he carries? Oh my God, that if there was any defilement, he could be struck dead this morning. But the Day of Atonement must have been an awesome event. Hallelujah. Because on the day, all the children of Israel gathered around the door of the tabernacle. This was the same door where God had dealt old judgment to Miriam for questioning Moses' leadership. And you can find that in Numbers 12, 10 through 12. And to Dothan and Abiram for rising up against Moses in Numbers 16. Now the multitude stood in awe as Aaron the high priest entered the mystical room to meet with the Almighty God. Jesus, have his mercy, oh Lord, this morning. Have mercy, God. Have mercy. Oh God, they've been given illustrations about what went on the inside, but they were left to wonder. Their imagination probably took over. What must it be like in there? Does the Lord have a visible form? Their minds were going crazy. Is his voice like the fear inspiring one we heard at Mount Sinai? Is he kind and gentle, or is he frightening? My God, all the scenarios were going, because they never had that experience with the Lord this morning. Even David, our favorite psalmist, the psalmist of Israel, had restricted access, people, to God. Scripture says he communed with God. He knew the Lord as his defender, his refuge, his keeper, and his strength. No one spoke more majestically or powerfully of God than this man did. Yet even so, David didn't have the privilege of going into the most holy place. All through the Psalms, David speaks of yearning and panting after God. Glory, hallelujah. David spoke. He speaks of yearning and panting after God. He cried out to get beyond the veil, to something he could not attain. Deep calleth unto deep, is what he said in Psalms 42, verse 7. Deep calleth unto deep. This morning, that's why I said press your way in. Press your way in, because deep calleth unto deep. This morning, as it's uttered in Psalms 42 and verse 7, hallelujah, because deep calleth unto deep this morning. Get into the inner court and meet your Savior. Hallelujah, this morning, glory, hallelujah. Solomon also expressed this kind of unmet yearning to the Lord. My beloved, put in his hands by the hole of the door, and my bowels were moved for him. I rose up to open my beloved. I opened to my beloved, but my beloved had withdrawn himself and was gone. I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. This is found in Solomon 5:4-6. Yes, I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. because here is a language of divine longing. I saw him. I yearned for him. I wanted him, but I couldn't find him. Ooh. So Israel saw God as dwelling in the temple. Ah, they saw God dwelling in the temple, in the room called the most holy place. So Solomon built a majestic temple in Jerusalem. When the structure was finished, he brought in the things that David, his father, put in the king, the silver, the gold, and all the instruments. They brought up the ark into his place. That's what happened in Chronicles 5:1-7. After everything was put in place, Solomon invited God to come and to sanctify the most holy place with his presence. And God did, descending in a cloud and filled the temple. Oh my God, can you envision that? God descended in a cloud and filled the temple. And everyone in Israel believed God resided in the great temple in Israel, in Jerusalem. Therefore, the Israelites directed all their prayers towards it. That's what they did. They directed all their prayers to the great temple of Jerusalem. But Solomon asked the Lord, if thy people go out to war against their enemies, by the way that thou shalt send them, and they pray unto thee towards the city which thou hast chosen and the house which I have built for thy name, then hear thou from the heavens their prayer and their supplication and maintain their cause. That's what 2 Chronicles 6:34-35 says. Solomon was asking, Lord, when our enemies go to war against our enemies, when our armies go to war against our enemies, hear them as they offer prayers towards you here in your temple. Give them access in battle. They thought of God as not being on the battlefield, but in that holy room in Jerusalem. Like some of us think that God is only in a building, but we don't think that God is on the battlefield with us. Hallelujah, but God is in the building. Moreover, Israel went into captivity. They were to pray toward their land and toward the house which I have built for thy name. Then hear thou from the heavens, is what he says. This is why Daniel opened his window in Babylon and prayed towards Jerusalem. Ah, that is Daniel 6:10. That's why Daniel opened his window in Babylon and prayed toward Jerusalem. And today the Jews still turn towards Jerusalem to pray. Yet in spite of God's glory in the temple, in spite of visions and dreams given to prophets, in spite of visitations of angels, God's people remained outside the veil. The door of the holy place hadn't yet been opened. And access to God was still restricted. I hope somebody's grabbing a hold of this morning. And access to God was still restricted. You can go, but so far. So restricted access in the New Testament is my third point. Christ's life in human flesh provided greater access to the Father. Yet even then, access was still very restricted. When Jesus came to the world as a babe, only a few people were present. A handful of shepherds and wise men. The rest of humankind was oblivious to him coming. Back at the temple in Jerusalem, the priests were going about their duties, and the people were saying prayers, all following their usual routine. Because access was still limited. When Jesus was a young boy, a few people saw him in the temple. But these were mostly priests and scribes who marveled at his knowledge of God's word. But the general public didn't know about him. Later, others met him in the carpenter's shop where he toiled. But who could believe Jesus was God in flesh? As he repaired the broken chairs, he was merely Joseph's son, a fine young man who knew a lot about God and his word, because he was word. Hallelujah, in flesh. Hallelujah. When Jesus began his ministry, he directed his words to a small population in a small country. To the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And because he could only be in one place at a time, access to him was restricted by logistics. If you wanted to get to Jesus, you had to go to Judah. Hallelujah. So if you lived outside of Israel, you had to travel for days or weeks by boat, by camel or foot. Then you had to trace his presence to a village to find a crowd there and ask them to locate him. Or if he had just left town, you had to listen for rumors to find out where he was going. You might have to hire a boat to take you to the other side of a large lake, or walk all day and night to get to the wilderness where he was teaching the masses. Do you understand what this is all about this morning? Glory be to Yahweh. Once you found Jesus, you had to be physically close to hear his voice, to receive his touch, be blessed by his holy presence. You could try to make your way through the crowd to get to him, but everyone else wanted to be near him too. Can you understand what you got this morning? Can you understand? So this was a most restricted access. So to get to the Lord, you had to be in the right place at the right time. Underscore that. You had to be in the right place at the right time. And let me tell you why I'm saying that. Consider the blind man who heard Jesus passing by. When this man learned who it was, he cried out, "Jesus, heal me, that I may receive my sight." Only then did Christ restore him. Consider point number two. Consider the woman with the issue of blood. She had to press through a crowd to touch the hem of Jesus' garment. All the while, everybody else was trying to touch him as well, but she pressed through the crowd to touch the hem of Jesus's garment. Number three, there was also the mother of Nain, who led a funeral procession to bury her dead son. When Jesus crossed her path, he touched the bier, meaning the base, the rest, and raised the boy from the dead. Think of this. Think of the impotent man at the pool of Bethesda in the sheep market. Many sick and afflicted people had gathered there to be healed, but this one man was in the right place at the right time, in the right place at the right time, as Jesus passed by him and he healed him as well. So in all these scenarios, you had to calculate or plan ahead of time to get access to the Lord. Zacchaeus did this, climbing a tree to get a glimpse of Jesus. Four other men solved a similar logistical problem on behalf of a sick friend when they located the crowded building where Jesus was teaching, and they opened a hole in the roof and lowered their friend right in front of Jesus' eyes. Are you in the right place? This statement was for the children of old, not for us, because you have unrestricted access. You don't have to locate him. You don't have to travel miles and thousands of miles to find him. You have unrestricted access. That's why. Here is why. The fearing of the veil. So finally, one sudden glorious moment, Jesus provided total, unrestricted access to the Father. The Bible says that at Golgotha, on a bloody stained cross, Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. Matthew 27, 50 to 51. At the moment of Jesus' death, the veil in the temple in Jerusalem was literally ripped apart. That's the moment our destiny was sealed. Mighty God of Zion, in the instance that our Lord gave up the ghost, we were given total unrestricted access to the Holy of Holies, having therefore brethren boldness to enter in into the holiest, hallelujah, by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil. That is to say, his flesh. Through the veil. That is to say, through his flesh. This tearing of the physical veil, his flesh, represented what took place in the spirit world. Finally, we were able to enjoy something that generation after generation. We had a privilege, even Abraham, Moses, David, and the forefathers of old didn't have. We have access to the Holy of Holies, the very throne room of Almighty God. The door was no longer shut to us. Anyone could now see inside and walk in. Not only are you able to see inside, but you could walk on in. Unrestricted access was made possible this morning. Unrestricted access. Moreover, at his death, Jesus became our high priest. He ascended to the new Jerusalem, to a temple not made with hands. There he took on the role of high priest. He walked right into the holy presence of God. Ah, my God. And with the incense of his own intercessions, presented his blood at the mercy seat. Then he sat down at the Father's right hand with all power, all might, and glory. With all might, all power, and glory. Do you understand what this means? At this point, Jesus claimed his covenant right to receive into one spiritual body all who would repent and receive him. And he sent the Holy Spirit to issue a call to his children. And here is a call this morning. I have opened the door to the Father. Sent the Holy Spirit to issue a call to his children. When I have opened the door to the Father. You are now accepted simply by being in me by faith. So come boldly to the throne. I'll take you into the presence of my Father, who is now your Father. You have unrestricted access to him. Thank you. You have unrestricted access to him. Thank you. But there's a call to pray. Because many of us, the heartbreaking part is that we don't know the gift that we got. We don't know the access that we have. Because for centuries, God, people begged and pleaded to go through the veil. They yearned and they longed to see the blessing of our day. They longed to see the day that we now see. The access we now enjoy is the very access Moses yearned for. It's the same access David's heart panted for, but couldn't obtain it. It's the access Daniel never had. Though he prayed to the Lord through it's access we know. Access we know. But there's a call to be. And scriptures admonishes us that us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. For he is faithful, that promise. So this necessarily speaks prayer. God is urging us, come into my presence often, daily. You can't maintain your faith if you're not drawing near to God. If you don't boldly enter into his presence. If your faith is going and wavering by the wayside. Draw close to him. Draw close. He's warning against you being lukewarm. Where are you this morning with the Lord? Where are you? Are you rejecting him? Are you running in only because of a situation? This morning, the only time he hears you is when trouble is at your door. Where are you with the Lord this morning? Should never be because of trouble that you run in. But the internal significance this morning is God has made Christ our strong tower. But only through those who run into it are saved. That's what Proverbs 18:10 says. If you don't go in, then you are still outside the door. You stand where Israel stood. But God doesn't meet anyone at the door anymore. Underscore that. You stand where Israel stood. But God doesn't meet anyone at the door anymore. All the provisions we need is inside. Forgiveness of sin. Mercy in time of need. Power to overcome. All his provisions we need our inside. Do you understand this morning? I can just imagine the pain of rejection felt, or it's being felt by our Father and the Son. I envision this conversation perhaps taking place. Son, you are beaten, mocked, and crucified and buried. It so pained the Lord, I shut my eyes at the sight. Yet you fulfilled the everlasting covenant. You provided acceptance and access for all who would trust in you. Because of you, a last day people would be able to come to me freely. And they will grow mighty in strength, building reserve of faith against the devil who want to tempt and rip them apart. Yet, we are the beloved children. Monday passes, and we never see them. Tuesday arrives, and still no children. Wednesday comes with no sight of them. Thursday, Friday, Saturday pass, yet still we don't see them. Only on Sunday, today, October 1st, do they approach us while they are in church. And that's it. Only on Sunday do they approach us while they are in church. Why don't they come? They love us. Why don't they come? And here is why I know that the Lord is asking these questions. God asked Adam the same question when he hid from the Lord in the Garden of Eden. Adam, where art thou? In Genesis 3 and 9. The Lord knew where Adam was all along. He was really asking Adam why he had rejected his fellowship. He was showing Adam that there was danger in hiding from his presence. Christians who don't have appropriate access to the Father end up in Sardis condition. The Lord instructed John unto the angel of the church in Sardis, write, these things said he that has seven spirits of God, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead, in Revelation 3 and 1. Jesus is saying, you may be a good person, and many of us talk like that all the time. Someone who will do anything for anyone. You have got a good reputation among both the church and the world. You're known as being truly alive in Christ. Blessed. What an element of death has creeped into your life. Something of the world has defined you. Believers in Sardis hadn't been watching. They hadn't been in prayer, waiting on the Lord, seeking him as they once had. Instead, they allowed themselves to grow careless, not coming to God daily for help. And now a defilement had been laid on them. The word Jesus used for defiled here signifies a soil of sin, a black mark on a white garment. Christ is telling us, if you don't pray, you have no defense against the enemy. Your negligence allows your garment to be stained. Don't ignore the gift. Our future depends on it. Pray and seek the Lord because he provided you access and he promises to meet your every need. So in closing this morning, access to God is a profound gift. A gift that was given was often taken for granted. It's given, but it's taken for granted. And the journey through our historical history from restricted access in the Old Testament to the tearing of the veil of Jesus' death paints a vivid picture of the privilege we now have as believers. You can boldly enter into the Holy of Holies by passing the angels and the heavenly host. Our forefathers and prophets of old, such as Abraham, Moses, and David, had some measure of access and still longed for more. The contrast with our present unrestricted access through Christ highlights the magnitude of the gift that we have today. The tearing of the veil symbolizes the opening of the way to God's presence, a privilege even our forefathers of the past didn't fully experience. Won't you receive him today? Let's not take this incredible access for granted. Instead, let's approach the throne of grace with boldness, recognizing the privilege and responsibility that comes with it. Access to God is not just a right. It's an invitation to deep, meaningful communion with our Heavenly Father. I want to remind you that Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," in John 14 and 6. His blood is a new and living way, in Hebrews 10 and 20. Only through him have we access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, in Romans 5 and 2. Through him, we both have access by one spirit unto the Father, Ephesians 2 and 18, in whom we have access in confidence through our faith, in Ephesians 3 and verse 3. Today, I pray you're blessed. I pray you are blessed this morning. I pray that you receive him. I pray that as of today, you will know the unrestricted access you have in the Lord. That you can boldly go in 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days of the year. Summer, fall, winter, and spring. It doesn't matter. You have unrestricted access. You're no longer standing at the door, but you're walking. Move from the outer courts to the inner court. Walk right in. Walk right in. Know the God in whom you serve. Let prayer be your life so you can commune with him. So you can have an intimate relationship with him today. Let's pray. Most holy and most righteous Father, I just want to thank you for your indwelling word. For your indwelling presence, Lord. We thank you today, Lord God, for your wisdom, for the knowledge that you have bestowed upon your people. I pray today that, Lord God, we will no longer stay on the outer court, but we will go to the inner court, Lord, because a door has been opened, a veil has been ripped, and we have total access to you, Lord. I pray, Lord God, that we will continue to run and hide in you. We will continue to seek you daily. We will continue to approach your mercy seat, oh God, because you're available to us. Lord God, I pray that you touch the hearts, oh God, this morning that will hear your words. Oh God, I pray that they will yield unto you. They will say, I yield this morning. Oh God, they will say, thy servant heareth, oh God, this morning. Touch the heart, touch the mind. Oh God, and draw your people ever so close this morning to you as you draw close. Hallelujah. Draw us even closer to you, Lord. Hallelujah. Touch that one right now in the sound of the reaches of my voice, where the tears are falling, Lord. Oh God, wipe away every tear from that eye. Oh God, water them, oh God, this morning. Let them spring forward, oh God, this morning. Let there be a rebound, oh God. Let there be a rebuilding of the wall, oh God. Let there be a rebuilding and a restoration and a recharge and a restorement, oh God. Let there be reconciliation that take place this morning, Lord. Ha, 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 ha. Because you are available to all of us this morning, and we give you all the thanks and all the praise. And so as your children come, Lord, this morning, hallelujah, let there be reconciliation, oh God, as you restore them, oh God, to who that you have called them to be. Hallelujah. And we bless you and we thank you for what you are about to do as your message falls upon your people and it take root in our heart and in our spirit. We give you thanks and we give you praise. Amen and amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Bless you, hallelujah. Recharge Ministries, hallelujah. Hallelujah is a God-sent ministry from the Lord. And we are but his agents doing his work in the earth realm this morning. And we give him all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. Be blessed today. Be blessed today. Be blessed in the city. Be blessed in the field. Hallelujah. In your going out and your coming in, may you be blessed and may you receive his glory and his presence as it shineth upon you. So walk right in this morning. Access fully granted unto you because you have unrestricted access. God bless you this morning. God.